Hello and welcome again to Conscious TV. I'm Iain McNay. And our guest in the studio today is Gary Latchman. Hi, Gary. And Gary's written many books, about 11 books, and he actually has a dual identity in one way, because he was the original bass player in the band Blondie, and he wrote a book about his life in Blondie and also the whole New York scene at that time, New York rocker. And his latest book is called Jung the Mystic, as Gary Latchman. So there's quite a difference in those worlds, and we're going to look at how those worlds intertwined for Gary over the years, and just basically hear the story of his life up until now. So, Gary, you, as a child, I know you were very influenced by monster movies and comic books. So something was brewing in you then, wasn't it?
Yeah. Well, I mean, you could say that, you know, if I have a path, you know, sort of put me on it then. I mean, I remember when I was about 5 years old, I started reading comic books, and there was a character called Cosmic Boy. He was one of the Legion of Superheroes that was in the back of Superboy comics or Adventure comics, one of those. In any case, I remember asking my sister what cosmic meant, and she didn't know, and my parents didn't know either. So I guess I've been trying to find out ever since. In some way, you could say that. But no, I mean, I grew up with all of monster movies, comic books, science fiction books, fantasy paperbacks, horror, all that stuff. I mean, that was a major influence on me.
And then the first band that you saw that you mentioned in New York Rocker that really kind of did something for you was, of course, the New York Dolls. And it inspired you to wear makeup for a time when you were a teenager.
Well, yeah, I mean, that's the early 70s. I mean, I guess I was coming of age in the early 70s, kind of the aftermath of the 60s sensibility and the early, well, we called it glitter rock in the States. I think it was glam over here. A friend, well, the drummer, who turned out to be the drummer from Blondie later on, he knew about the New York Dolls, and they were just very, very exciting. And what was great about them is that at this time, when I started listening to them, this is about 73, you had to sort of play, to be able to play sort of rock music, you had to go to the Juilliard School of Music, because you had all these bands like Emerson, Lake and Palmer, or Yes, all these big Wagnerian, you know, sort of operatic kind of music that was this huge sort of thing. And I couldn't possibly ever play anything like that. But the Dolls, I mean, the Dolls, that, you know, they had songs with three chords. And it convinced me and lots of other people that you didn't really need to play like Hendrix or Eric Clapton. I have nothing against those guys, but it's just, you know, only a few people can sort of do that, or at least I couldn't. But if you just hit an A chord with a lot of chutzpah, you might say, just had a real sort of get up, do it yourself sort of thing, and that's what inspired me. And then also, as you say, they wore makeup. They had this sort of strange sexual ambiguity about them, and this was the same time as David Bowie was sort of becoming known in the States, and Lou Reed and all that. And that was very different than the previous sort of 60s Love Generation sort of thing. It was darker. It was a bit more mysterious. And that's sort of the milieu that I guess came of age in the early 70s when I sort of started hanging out in New York in clubs.
And it was Johnny Thunders that particularly, I think, inspired you, wasn't it?
Oh, yeah, well, I'm saying he was the guitarist in the Dolls, and he just was a great rock guitarist. Again, he couldn't play like Clapton or any of these super lead guitarists, but when he hit an A chord, or if he hit, you know, a sort of note, it's unmistakable that it was his sound. And watching them play, I mean, I basically felt like I could do that. You know, I mean, not in the sense that what he was doing wasn't good, but just that it was so simple, but it had so much character in it. I used to go see them. There was a place called Club 82 in the East Village. It's not there anymore. And it was an old transvestite bar. There really weren't too many places where you could play in New York at that time. There was Max's Kansas City, but that had actually closed down. And there wasn't too many places for unsigned bands, you know. There was a place called The Bottom Line, but these were all established, you know, acts, a real underground sort of scene. Earlier, there was a place called the Mercer Arts Center, but that literally collapsed, that fell apart. And Club 82 started letting rock bands play every now and then. Then it became, before CBGB took over, which was the club that most people know about, the New York scene. Club 82 was this place where people liked the Dolls. There was an early version of Blondie called the Stilettos.
And that's when you first played, met that's Chris Stein. That's when I first saw Debbie them. Harry,
yeah. I saw them play one night. I think they even opened for. I think they opened for Wayne County. Yeah. One evening. So.
It was interesting because you were saying you saw them at this club and they were actually playing on the floor in the corner. Reminding me, I first time I saw the Police in London, they were playing on the floor of a pub in Putney with 30 people there. And you forget that these bands, they actually start in venues that are very small and with no real presence as such in terms of...
absolutely. I mean, when I first met Debbie and Chris, as I said, the drummer, Clem Burke, he and I went to the same high school together in New Jersey, and I used to carry his drums in to high school dances and things like that, and he had answered an ad in the Village Voice, a band looking for a drummer, and so the Village Voice was, at the time, sort of an underground New York newspaper. It's not so much anymore, and he went over, auditioned for them. It turned out to be, you know, Debbie Harry and Chris Stein. The bass player they had, he soon quit to join a group called Television. Richard Hell, who had played bass in Television, he had left because he wanted to start his own group. And so there was a hole. They needed a bass player. And I was living in New York at the time. I was writing a lot of bad poetry. I was working as a messenger, starving. And I could sort of, kind of, almost maybe play, which is what you needed at the time. More to the point, I looked the part. I was really thin. and scraggly looking, looked sort of, you know, like I was at the end of things, and I'd gone to a few shows already of theirs, as you say, seeing them play in these dives, basically down on the Wall Street area, financial district in New York, and playing for whatever they could get, and Clem just said, well, why don't you come and audition? So I wound up going to their rehearsal studio, and we just jammed on a Stone song, Live With Me, I think for about a half hour, playing the same thing over and over, and they said, all right. And I quickly transformed writing the poetry into writing songs. So this is spring, April of 1975.
And then you actually moved in with Chris and Debbie because you had nowhere to live.
Settled on their settee for a time. That's true. Yeah, my mother didn't care for my playing in a rock band in New York and coming in at 4 or 5 in the morning, so understandably. I left home and I went over to New York, and I just told them I didn't have anywhere to live, and I was crashing at different, you know, people's couches and studios and things like that. And then Debbie said, well, why don't you can come stay with us for a while. So they had a tiny one-bedroom flat in Little Italy, which is, you know, you've seen it in all the sort of Al Pacino movies, and it's sort of the place where the mafia live and all that. And we lived in this tiny place for a few months before we moved into a bigger loft space on the Bowery.
So you wrote their first single, Ex-Offender, mm-hmm. and you became quite an important part of the band, mm-hmm. and the whole thing started to take off pretty quickly.
Well, as I said, they had been around for a while, trying to get, you know, things going. And then when Clem joined, it was a real sort of stimulant for them because he was younger. I mean, they were a bit older than both of us. I mean, we were still teenagers. And then I joined and started writing some songs. And then it kind of just started to gel more. And then we got a keyboardist, a fellow named Jimmy Destry. And then we hunkered down and sort of developed this kind of early retro 60s sort of sound. I mean, this is 75. I mean, I'd grown up listening to AM radio in the 60s, and there was nothing but good pop music on. If it wasn't the British Invasion bands, it was sort of the San Francisco sound or Motown and all that. So I just grew up with all these great melodies. And that's what came out when I started, you know, writing songs, that sort of 60s.
Did it come easy to you, songwriting?
Surprisingly so. I mean, the thing was that you learn a few chords, at the same time, the people I was learning from were like the Velvet Underground, who, you know, have 2 or 3 chords in their songs, or the Dolls, or Iggy Pop, or also going back to the old Phil Spector girl group sound. I mean, there are all these easy progressions, but again, there's a lot of character and attitude and authenticity in it. You know, it has a real kind of, and how to say it, there's a power in it, even though the musically it's simple. And so once I learned how to do that, it did sort of come out fairly easily. I mean, mind you, that's sort of what I did. I mean, I never really progressed very far with music. I mean, I could play what I play and what I like, but I'm not, you know, I wouldn't consider myself a musician's musician in that sense. But yeah, it was and it was also exciting. It was exciting to be 18, 19, right, jumping around, playing this stuff. And then, you know, because all these musicians I did know growing up, you know, they would spend hours working away trying to learn a Jimi Hendrix lick, but they never left, you know, their rooms. You know, they never, I mean, I was the guy who couldn't play, but I'm there, you know, jumping around on stage in New York. So it was a strange sort of place to be in the first place. But I mean, it more than anything else, it convinced me that, you know, having confidence, really, and not being afraid taking a risk is if not more, you know, is at least 50% of the thing. And if you wait until you think, you know, you've got it perfectly right, you're never going to do anything.
No, it's a good way to approach things. Mm. And it was through looking at Chris Stein's book collection, you found your two, we could call esoteric books. It was a Colin Wilson book, I think, and the Aleister Crowley book,
right,
is that?
Right, yeah. Well, Chris and Debbie too, to some extent, they had a kitschy kind of interest in occult things, voodoo and black magic and pentagrams and things like that, or books on UFOs. And also, there was still a lot of sort of debris left over from, the 60s in that scene in New York. So a lot of different books were on people's bookshelves, and you know, books like by Leary and Castaneda and all that. And I'd already read quite a lot of that when I was back in Jersey, people, you know, like Alan Watts and Suzuki, and I was a big Hermann Hesse fan. He was one of the millions of, you know, adolescents in the States that were reading Siddhartha and Damien and all that in the early 70s. But we were living in this loft on the Bowery, about a block away from CBGB. And one of the people living in the loft was an artist. And he painted these wild, extravagant sort of canvases based on sort of tarot cards. And he had the Crowley tarot deck, and he would do these impromptu sort of readings. And then a big book that was going around was Diary of a Drug Fiend. I mean, reasonably so, when you think about the milieu. Basically, it was about, you know, a book about somebody taking lots of different drugs and all that. And so that made the rounds. And I became interested in Crowley's, you know, thing for a while. But it was Colin Wilson's book, The Occult, that it just... Because I really didn't have any interest in the supernatural or anything like that. I mean, insofar as it was something that was material for horror movies or H.P. Lovecraft stories or things like that, I knew of it and was interested in it. And Arthur Machen, who was an English writer, he was in the Hermetic Order of the Golden Dawn, and he wrote horror stories. And so I had a vague sort of idea of it. But Wilson's book, this is a huge book that came out in the early 70s, he saw it sort of in the context of phenomenology and Western philosophy, and he's talking about people like Sartre and Nietzsche and so on, and then he's talking about Gurdjieff and Madame Blavatsky and others and Crowley on another page. And I had read a lot of the existentialists, and Nietzsche was a big influence on me, so it made sense. It sort of it came together, and he has such a readable, intelligent, engaging style.
So what were you looking for? There must have been some part of you searching for an answer, or
I think at that point how to be the Superman or something like that.
How to be Superman?
I would say,
yeah,
in some way. Again, it's this early influence of comic books. A strange visitor from another planet with powers and abilities far beyond those of mortal men.
So you wanted to go beyond the human.
Yeah, it was some that romantic sense of something more. You know, something more than the everyday humdrum. Again, which I think that comes natural to, you know, to you when you're young, and I was feeding that from in reading and in poetry and music and all that. But I think with reading Wilson's book, and also, you know, Crowley, I mean, you know, for all of his failings, he did have the sense of there's something, some untapped power. There are these capacities and capabilities that, you know, most of us don't engage with out of fear or laziness and all that. And so there was some sense of, yes, you know, yeah, I think these guys are right. And how do I get to that? Basically.
Okay. Mm. And then meanwhile, Blondie, you had your first album out on Private Stock Records. As I said, you wrote Experiment, their first single, and you came on a UK tour,
right,
with Television. I actually saw you, one of the Croydon Greyhound, I remember.
Oh, right.
It's the first time I saw Blondie, yeah. Which must have been around 77.
77, yeah. Yeah. It was spring of 77, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was a great tour. It's the first time I came to London. I had grown up an Anglophile, or at least a swinging Londonphile, because of I grew up listening to the Beatles and the Stones and the Zombies and all those groups, and then also a lot of the popular culture, the James Bond films, the Avengers. It was Danger Man here, but in the States it was Secret Agent Man, The Prisoner, and I'd read all the Sherlock Holmes stories and, I mean, all that sort of thing. So I had had this romantic view of London, which since I've lived here, I've been disabused of, but I still love it nonetheless. But that was fantastic to come here then. I was, I don't know, 20 or 21, something like that.
Because you were bigger actually in the UK than you were in America.
Yeah, I mean, at that time, I don't know. I mean, this was, the first album was only out for a few months. We weren't you, but in the sense of here, a lot of people were interested in what was coming over from New York, just like the same in New York or in the States. People were interested in the music that was coming out of here. So it was a strange tour because we supported television. Marquee Moon, the television's first album, was huge over here. It was a big hit. And we'd go to the, you go to the shows and you see the audience. There would be a lot of, how should I say it, flannel-shirted, long-haired guys that they wouldn't be out of place at a Grateful Dead concert. And it's understandable because the first album, television album, there's a lot of guitar solos and they're a real guitar band. I mean, Blondie, again, we're this sort of retro girl group kind of sound band. And I think compared to television, we were like this bubblegum, you know, cartoon, I think, to most of the audience. Though there was a contingent every place we played, these sort of early punks, I guess you would call them, or early new wave, who, you know, Bournemouth and Sheffield and all these other places. Yeah. And I know here at the Hammersmith Odeon, that was one show I remember pretty vividly about that tour. And I know there's a big crowd here too. So, the second album did very well here, and my song Presence Dear was on that, and that was a hit single.
So you wrote the song I'm Only Touched by Your Presence Dear, which was top 10. But by then you'd left the band.
Just right before the second album, they went into record. I wound up leaving.
You fell out with Debbie Harry, didn't you? Basically.
I guess with both of them, Debbie, but I guess more so Debbie. I mean, looking back now, 30-something years ago, I mean, it's understandable in some way. I mean, I was this young guy, I was jumping around. They were always afraid I was going to decapitate Debbie because I was pogoing all the time.
Really?
Yeah, I had the big bass, you know, this Fender Precision bass, and I was just jumping around all the time. And they said, no, you know, no. But what had happened was, as always happens in these stories, you get, you know, the money turns up, the shirts arrive, and then there's a manager, and he's saying what you should do, and, you know, Debbie could have made it without, you know, the band probably. But at the same time, you know, we wrote a lot of the material. We developed the sort of look. I mean, I was wearing all skinny ties all the time, and Converse, I got them on now. And this kind of, again, this sort of retro 60s look. So it was a package, but I'm sure for record company people, you know, Debbie was the moneymaker. You can get any band to back them up. So, again, with hindsight, I can see why they would have, it wouldn't have been too happy with me, but also, I mean, I just wanted to do that because I just felt, well, you know, I'm just as creative and whatever as they are, and why should I take a back seat? And that's I still have that attitude today.
But
it's got me into a lot of trouble.
Was quite a brave move, and then you moved to LA, and that was when you started your more deep spiritual search, shall we say, and you get Spensky. You got into him.
By the time I got into L.A., I started reading Uspensky's stuff and then into Gurdjieff. For a while, when I first was in Los Angeles, I was involved with the Crowley group. I think I might still be a member of the OTO. I don't know anymore. One of his magical organizations. I pursued that for a while and did some rituals and was involved in some sort of Gnostic masses and things like that. But after a while, I got kind of fed up with Crowley because he's an incredibly claustrophobic character after a while, because he's basically just talking about himself all the time. And initially, you know, it's this wild, flamboyant, rollicking life that's quite, you know, impressive. You know, he climbs the Himalayas and whatever, walks across China and takes all this massive drugs and has sex with anything. And it's the sort of thing you're into when you're about 20 or 21. But then I started just becoming disenchanted with his sort of egotistic, his egotism. And also the people I was with, it was more like a Aleister Crowley fan club. We kind of basically just sat around and wished we could do those things ourselves.
So it's like giving your power away in one way.
Yeah, well, it's just something, I think, you know, one gets attracted to these very flamboyant types at different times. And in fact, I have to give Crowley credit because he did it, because he went to that extreme. Others don't have to do that. You can see, oh, well, this doesn't work. You know, there's the old Blake saying, the road of excess leads to the palace of wisdom. And I think in someone like Crowley's case, it's true. You know, he took the whole notion of excess to the end. And us who come after, we can see, well, actually, that's sort of a dead end. It doesn't do what it is supposed to do. So I'm glad he did, and I'm glad I followed his footsteps for a while, and then I just outgrew it. And one of the reasons I outgrew it, because I was reading more and more of Colin Wilson's work. I was a much deeper, insightful thinker. And he was introducing me to people like Uspensky and Gurdjieff and others. And
you came to England and you met Colin Wilson and became friends with him.
Yeah, this was... that was 83. I came... this is after I dropped out of music. I had my own band in Los Angeles for a while.
Yes.
Called The No. We made a few records.
And they actually got their name from the word Gnostic, didn't they?
I was very interested in the Gnostics at the time. I was reading Elaine Pagel's book on it, The Gnostic Gospels. And also I was going to a lot of lectures by a man named Stefan Heller in Los Angeles. He would lecture at Manly P. Hall's Philosophical Research Society, which is this fantastic... sort of Art Deco, sort of Mesoamerican style building, sort of in the Hollywood Hills. Manly P. Hall had been around forever. He's most known for this huge coffee table book, The Secret Teachings of All Ages. But they would have these lectures on Sunday afternoons, and I went to hear Stefan Heller talk about the Gnostics quite a bit. And he spoke of them sort of in a Jungian context. And he's written a book about Jung in the Seven Sermons to the Dead. So in any case, I was quite interested in the whole Gnostic idea and this whole notion of, you have to bring forth what's within you, and if you don't, it'll destroy you. You know, if you bring forth, it'll save you, but if you don't do it, it'll kill you. And in many ways, again, I could see that in a Nietzschean kind of context. You know, if you don't sort of, Blake says much the same thing, if you don't sort of bring forth or use the sort of powers or capacities you have, they sort of fester and sour and rot inside you, and they make you not a nice person. So
at one point you joined the Gurdjieff group. Was that a bit later?
What's mixing up dates? Actually, before I moved to Los Angeles, I did in my last days in New York. I was getting more and more interested in Gurdjieff, and with this sort of thing, much like getting involved with the Crowley group, I thought, well, it's better to sort of actually, you know, plunge into this and do it, see what it's like, rather than just sort of think about it and read it. So I had gone to a lecture about the Gurdjieff work at the Barbizon Hotel in the Upper East Side in New York. And strangely enough, I was sharing a flat with a friend, an older gentleman, and we talked quite a bit about Kabbalah and, you know, a variety of different other sort of mystical paths, and he was very interested in all these sorts of things. And I'd mentioned that I was becoming more interested in Gurdjieff, and that I was reading all the books, and I had gone to this talk. And then the next, I don't know, week or so later, he said, well, are you still really interested in, you know, the Gurdjieff work? And I said, yeah. And he said, well, here's, you know, call this number. And I didn't know. He had been involved in it for some time. So it was this strange sort of way, you know, the introduction to it was right there, and I didn't know. And so I wound up going to a small group in New York, and that was, I don't know, less than a year probably, but it was very, you know, interesting, sounds so banal, but we met in a little basement room in the Upper East Side, and was taught a series of different exercises. And
so what were you actually taught? What were the exercises?
Well, I guess there's a classic one. This is what they call the sensing exercise. You sort of sit, you know, you sit like this, and then you sort of sense your arm, and then, you know, this leg, then this leg, then here, then you start this leg and then carry on. You do sort of a canon until...
So I mean,
it was this whole notion of sensation. They rooted it, everything, in having a real strong, vivid sensation of your feeling of your body. So, you know, so much can just be just up in your head and up in the air and so on and so on. So everything was rooted in this kind of sensing. And then... self-remembering exercises and things of that sort.
So what's self-remembering?
Well, it's being aware of your inner and your outer world at the same time, being aware of yourself and being... I mean, I feel a little bit of it right now because this is an unusual situation. You're slightly more heightened perception of yourself. But right. It's, you know... I mean, the classic thing, as Gary Jeff Uspensky say, most of the time we're either preoccupied with what's going on outside or, you know, with our own thoughts. And it's... those times when the two are present at the same time, that it's a whole different feel, it's a whole different sort of taste or flavor to your consciousness.
You have more awareness of what actually is happening. Yeah.
I mean, they use all different words, you're more present.
Yeah.
You know, in some way. And in many ways, I would say the work I've done later, when I was writing books about Jung and Steiner and all that, it's very much, again, it's this bringing this sort of inner and outer experience together at the same time, something I call the Goldilocks effect, when things are just right, you know, when the two things come together just right, but that's perhaps later on. But yeah, I this is about 1981. I moved to California in 82, got into a Gurdjieff group there, and would, you know, weekly meetings, and then have these weekends where you would do these sort of intensive kind of work sorts of things. I mean, it's all the classic stuff. You'd paint a fence, and then they would tell you it's the wrong color. And then you'd have to deal with the sense of frustration. And then, okay, actually, it's not about the fence. It's about, you know, using this somehow to be more aware of myself and so on. And, I mean, a few moments where I felt some real unalloyed, you know, presence and clarity of consciousness.
This is a classic Gurdjieff thing, wasn't it? You get people to spend all day digging a trench and then you'd say... Well, you know, you have to fill it in.
Exactly. Yeah. I mean, that's the thing. I even found myself laughing. I said, oh, this is it. I'm getting the Gurdjieff treatment. And I did that for a few years. And in 83, with a friend of mine, we went on this sort of mini search for the miraculous. Basically, we came to Europe and we went to places like Chartres Cathedral and Stonehenge and Avebury. We found, we went to Fontainebleau to find the Prairie, where Gurdjieff had his Institute of Harmonious Development of Man. In the 20s, we found that. We did sort of a pilgrimage to Gurdjieff's, where he had his flat in Paris, the Rue de Colonel Renard, near the Étoile. But it was also on that time that I, as you say, I went to, we separated at a certain point. I wound up going down to, I was very interested in standing stones and ley lines.
To go back to Gurdjieff, yeah. I think you also tried the movements, didn't you?
I tried these once,
the Hartman music, your arms and legs in different ways. And you have to be so concentrated.
No, you're absolutely right. I mean, I had a remarkable experience doing those. So I couldn't do them. I mean, you know, it's a sort of, you know, that kind of thing, but... you know, 50 times more difficult. And I kept sort of trying to do this particular combination and I can't do this, and kept falling out. And again, it was a classic thing where at some point I said, well, look, I'm just going to force myself. And I kept trying to do it. And then it suddenly clicked and I could do it. And I felt this, you know, sudden rush of energy and power and vitality and alertness. And I mean, I talk about it in my book on Uspensky, and I say, I mean, I wanted to hop in my car and just drive up to San Francisco just for the fun of it and back. You know, I just felt so invigorated. And, I mean, I've come to think, I mean, whether Gurdjieff learned these things and you know, from the Sarmung Brotherhood or not, that he claims to have sort of made contact with this ancient esoteric order, they seem very much like William James talked about something, the psychologist philosopher William James talked about something very similar, the whole phenomenon of second wind, where you reach a certain resistance in yourself, you reach a certain level of fatigue. And he says, if you can push past that, if you're not sort of taken in by that fatigue, you suddenly have this influx of, you know, much more energy and power.
So you're opening yourself up to a wider energy source somehow. Yeah.
Well, I think we have levels. He talks about, you know, we reach this a certain level or degree of fatigue, and we tend to say, okay, that's it, I'm tired, you know, and then you kind of, and out of habit, you do that over time, and just out of habit, that's how you react. But he talks about what he calls the bullying treatment, how with some patients who have become sort of neurasthenic, they're just so utterly sensitive to life, the slightest little effort is too much for them, how what the doctor would do would force them to make some kind of effort, sort of just take them to the brink, basically, where they just, you know, think, I can't possibly do this, I'm going to faint or collapse. And then that would happen. They would find this renewed energy. And they would get the energy, but they would also learn that sense of fatigue or that sense of resistance or that sense of reluctance that they were feeling was false. It was a lie in some way. It was, you know, trying to pull one over on you. And I think, you know, again, I'm not trying to diminish Gurdjieff's work, but it's interesting to me when you see parallels in other people's work. And I think William James is, you know, as brilliant a psychologist as Gurdjieff was and all that. And so in some way that's carried over to later life as well. That's one of the things I've kept sort of with me is don't let yourself give way to sort of the first kind of levels of tiredness or fatigue about something, or again the sense of reluctance or the whole idea that something's not worth doing. Because I think the whole effort, I think, is one of the only, in fact, I would say effort is the only incontrovertible sign we have of any kind of free will and freedom. I mean, it's the one thing, I think, if anything else can be explained in terms of determinism or cause and effect, the notion of effort, I don't think can, because effort is basically, you have to sort of decide to do more than what, and what is it that decides to do that? There's some essential you there that makes that effort, as it were.
I made a note looking at my notes here out of Europe. When you talk about your experiences with Gurdjieff group, the back of your Ouspensky book, you talk about a lecture you went to in New York where they were talking about the difference between I and it.
Yeah.
Did that impact you when you heard that?
Well, again, yeah, it's the separation of, okay, well, there's, you know, there's, well, we tend to have a sense of me, I, is this kind of homogenous thing that's there all the time. But then very much a part of the Gurdjieff work is being able to detect this difference, you know, or this distinction between there's something that's more you, more vitally you, and then there's, I mean, they talk about the machine, there's something that just kind of rambles on, you know, automatically.
Yeah.
And yeah, I mean, that impacted on me. And, you know, I mean, once you get into these things, or at least I did, you start seeing all this stuff that they talk about, and it becomes very convincing. You see yourself acting mechanically, or you see yourself acting habitually, it's very, very convincing. Now, mind you, in the end, the problem I had, I think, with the Gurdjieff work is that there's a lot of stick, but there's not enough carrot for me. So that's why I sort of, in the end, I found
it. You found it a bit negative in one way.
Well, it seemed to me very much focused on, you know, you're being asleep and being mechanical and what you cannot do and all that, which, okay, in one sense, it's understandable. If you're complacent, or if you, you know, you feel that you're perfectly free and all that, then you're not going to be sort of aware of, you know, the limitations you have and all that. So, but I think once you get I think Gurdjieff, he's very pessimistic about human possibility, even though he presented this whole system. You know, I think he basically thinks that, you know, most people just aren't going to make it. And it's best to err on the side of beating them and then err on the side of sort of embracing them and telling them they're doing a good job. My own case, I just found that limiting. And then one of the reasons I wrote the book about Ouspensky is I thought he treated, you know, poor Ouspensky, I think he just treated him very badly. You know?
I should show this book to the camera, actually, because I read this book and I found it very interesting,
And so that was one of the things I think. I think Ouspensky was a very gentle, poetic, philosophical sort of soul, romantic sort of soul. When he met Gurdjieff, and then I think under the influence of this, you know, Gurdjieff's like this Zorba kind of character, this man's man. He's just, you know, very, very powerful and does no nonsense and all of that. And I think he just sort of. He made Ouspensky feel very unsure of himself, I think, after the time he spent with him. He learned a great deal, but I think he came away not being one thing or the other. He wasn't himself anymore, and he would never be the kind of character that Gurdjieff was. And so
I remember reading, you know, he was so ruthless, Gurdjieff, because I remember reading one of the books, De Hartman wrote.
Mm-mm.
And there was a time where the Second World War had just started and Gurdjieff sent him a telegram saying, you must come and meet me urgently. And he had to go across a whole war zone, right, several weeks.
Yes.
And he got there and it was over nothing. And Gurdjieff said, you can go back now.
Right.
And he had to go back through. And I think that finished De Hartman with Gurdjieff. Yeah, yeah. It was almost being ruthless for the sake of it.
Well, he did it pretty much to everybody he was involved with. I mean, and pretty much everyone broke with him in the end. But then again, you might say, well, that's exactly what he wanted them to do. Stand on your own 2 feet, you know. I mean, there's, you know, all these stories of people like J.G. Bennett and others that are just, they're trying to make sense of all this, in many ways, ill or abuse. You know, they're, no, master, why are you doing this to me? And basically it's like, well, you know, why are you sitting there taking it? Why don't you get up and stand on your own feet and go, you know, go do your own thing.
So you were more drawn to Colin Wilson for a time because he was more positive, wasn't he?
Yeah.
He was focused on his peak experiences a lot.
Yes, yes, yes. And peak experience, and also, again, he doesn't reject all of Western culture like many of these esoteric teachers do. That's all. I mean, that's very simplistic, but in some way there is this gesture of, like, you know, the thinking is bad, reason is bad, science, all this sorts of things, it's all left brain, and Wilson's not like that. You know, he's very much wants to understand these things philosophically and also existentially and practically. It's not armchair, it's not just purely detached academic study of these things. You know, he's very much interested in, as you say, the peak experience, these, you know, more, the greater potentials and possibilities of consciousness. That, I just found that much more attractive. It struck me as a more positive goal to sort of work towards. And again, I could go read all the books I really enjoyed without feeling like, oh, are these guys really asleep? Because, you know, Gurdjieff would say, oh, it doesn't matter, you could write any number of novels and still be asleep, or Beethoven was asleep when he wrote the Ninth Symphony. I just find it very difficult to accept that, you know. And when I was in the Gurdjieff group, again, this is many years ago, these sorts of things would come up, and I just sound like, well, okay, I can understand why you're saying that to make a point, but really, do you really think, you know, these people were asleep when they're writing these great music and these great poems and painting these great paintings? I just found it, I don't know, a bit too harsh and austere.
So. Anyway, to move forward, because my fault. I should be directing you more. So to move forward a few years, you're in your mid-40s and you were going through a bit of a marriage crisis. I don't want to focus on that. Right. But you got a phone call out of the blue from Chris Stein saying, do you want to rejoin Blondie for a tour?
Right.
Which was a big surprise, wasn't it?
Yeah, well, it was quite a surprise. I mean, in the meantime, I had... I went back to university. I got a degree in philosophy. I was working at the Bodhi Tree Bookshop in Los Angeles. It was this sort of the biggest metaphysical bookshop west of the Rockies and all of that sort of thing. And I wound up teaching at University of California. Not teaching. I was working for the science department at the University of California. And that didn't work out. The marriage I was in didn't work out, and I sort of went through this crisis in 40, and I decided that if I was ever going to write, because I'd written songs, I'd written some bad poetry, and I'd written a few articles, but I hadn't written a book yet. I just thought if I ever was going to do that, I'd have to do it now, or it'd be too late. And I took a big risk and a gamble, and left Los Angeles and moved to London. And strangely enough, after being here only a few months, as you say, I got this phone call from Chris Stein, and he wanted to put the band back together. So I thought that was rather odd. I hadn't heard from him in I don't know how long. But again, I was 40. How often does this happen? You know, so what the hell? You know, why not? So I wound up going back to the States for a while, living in New York, living with Chris again. He had this huge loft space in Tribeca area of New York, which was very fashionable. And if you know the film Performance, the Donald Camel film with Jagger, something like that, you know, Jagger's living in this kind of broken down mansion over Notting Hill. Well, this loft was sort of like that as well. It was kind of, kind of decayed grandeur, to put it mildly. So it was very strange to be back again. I mean, in a way, I wondered if Chris was performing some sort of magical ritual by trying to recreate the initial conditions of the Blondie's first sort of rise to success. So, you know, all three of us weren't living together because he and Debbie weren't together, but he and I were living together, and then we were playing in New York and doing all these sorts of things. And I thought, I wonder if he's trying to sort of recreate sorts of things. But it was funny doing it again. It was a lot of fun. I hadn't played music in many, many years.
Looking back, do you have any regrets about leaving when you left? Because they had 5 number ones in the UK. You would have made a lot of money out of it. Yeah.
Well, I mean, if I had regrets, I just couldn't have played that stuff. I mean, I wanted to play my own songs. That was one of the reasons, was that I wanted to more of my own songs. It was kind of the George Harrison syndrome. You know, I just, you know, I was allowed 1 or 2 songs, but not more than that. You weren't, you know, and again, I can understand now, basically Debbie was, you know, the moneymaker, she was a star, but we had all come up through the trenches. You know, we had all worked, we had all starved, we had all worked together, created the Blondie sound and all that. And I just felt like, well, no, I just want to go on and do my own thing. Yeah. And so it was fine. I mean, one thing I do regret is that a few more of my songs didn't get recorded. But they might, who knows, you know, people scour old tapes and, you know, CDs these days for material, so they might turn up somewhere. But no, I mean, Presence Here was a big hit. My own band, we didn't have any big hits, but, you know, we had notoriety. Yeah. And then I played with Iggy Pop for a year, which is, you know, one of the classic characters in rock. It was precisely after that tour that I gave up. That was the sex, drugs, and rock and roll tour for me. That was, you know, if I was talking about Crowley and Excess earlier, this was the one where I sort of followed that path. But then I found myself, you know, playing with them again and recording. But strangely enough, the same thing happened where, you know, the sort of personalities clashes. And I mean, I recorded with them, did quite a few big concerts in the States. And then, even, you know, they had more or less assured me that I would play on the album and so on, but it didn't happen. So it was fine.
So meantime, your writing career was taking off and you wrote a book about Rudolf Steiner. And I think you got quite involved with the Steiner movement, didn't you?
Well, not so much the movement as Steiner's work. I mean, while I was in the late 80s into the early 90s, when I was doing this philosophy degree and I was working at the bookshop, I became interested in Steiner's work because a lot of it is rooted in sort of German philosophy and idealism. You know, he writes about Kant a lot, and he did a book on Nietzsche and all that. Colin Wilson written a little book about Steiner, so I was always eager to, you know, or open to following something that he had, you know, pointed to. And then at the shop, there was like a whole wall of, you know, Steiner books and Steiner lectures. And I was looking and thinking, where the hell do you start with all this stuff? And so I just wound up, you know, reading the lectures here and there. And it just became, I became quite fascinated with them. I mean, this whole dichotomy, I guess, between, on one hand, he's writing something very acute about epistemology and Immanuel Kant and so on, and on the other page he's talking about Atlantis or, you know, reincarnation. So it was a strange sort of dissonance between, you know, rather pretty, you know, hard-nosed philosophy and, you know, rather eccentric
So for people ideas. That don't know much about Rudolf Steiner, what's, very briefly, what's his basic message or basic teaching?
Well, I guess the basic teaching is the sort of simple one, is that, you know, human beings are not only physical beings, but spiritual ones as well. And we have a whole other spiritual world that we more or less aren't aware of, but exists there nevertheless. And if you follow certain exercises and meditations that he suggests, you will become more aware of this other world. And that world is part of your consciousness. That's what I would say. You know, and this is one of the things I became very interested with Steiner is... his ideas about the evolution of consciousness, because I saw similar ideas with other thinkers. I must say that one of the people who really got me able to take Steiner seriously was Owen Barfield, who wrote quite a bit about Steiner. He's most known as being a very close friend of C.S. Lewis, and he was also a friend of Tolkien's. He was part of this little group called the Inklings that used to meet in Oxford in the 30s. But he wrote a series of essays about Steiner, linking him to people like Coleridge and others in the Romantic movement, mostly through sort of the theme of imagination. Steiner talks quite a bit about imagination, and imagination is a real vital active force, not, you know, the rationalist notion of imagination is just make-believe or pretend. You know, it's a real sort of creative energy, I guess. And so Barfield wrote essays linking Steiner to sort of literature, which I found it a good way to get into him. And he himself wrote about the evolution of consciousness as seen through language. He has a fascinating book called History in English Words, where he traces the development of sort of consciousness as evidenced by the changes in language, especially in English. And then I found this theme in other thinkers as well. There's a Swiss-German philosopher named Jean Gebser, who wrote a huge book called The Ever-Present Origin. And I write about him in a book of mine called The Secret History of Consciousness. Or I write about Steiner as well in that book. But he too has this theme of a sort of progression or a development of consciousness over time, you know, both individually and then culturally, you know, so historically. And this I just became quite keen on this idea.
And how was it for you kind of getting involved with researching and studying these different people? How was your consciousness progressing, evolving during this time?
Well, I mean, with any luck, you know, one hopes that the more you understand these things, the more you can apply them to yourself in some way. I mean, I know when I'm, how should I say, I know a book or something I'm writing is going well when I feel like, even though I know this already, I feel like I'm learning it now again. It becomes more real. It takes on another dimension. It becomes more visceral. And this is one of the things I've enjoyed about doing books on Jung or Uspensky or Steiner, Swedenborg. I've written a book on him as well. Is just that effort and that you know, staying with it for a long period of time, daily, and you keep coming back to it. And then, I mean, you know, it's not so much becoming a scholar of these people's works. It's actually, because there's only, I wouldn't consider myself a scholar of Steiner or of Swedenborg or these people, but there are certain aspects or elements of their work that I find particularly applicable to myself in some way, or just interest me, and I just plow into that. And the more you stay with that over time and keep coming back to it, it becomes real. I mean, Maurice Nicole, who was one of Grzegorz Uspensky's students, in one of his books, he says, ideas are real things. You know, they have a real life and a real power and a real energy. And this, I found this to be true. I mean, you can just think of some idea, all right, but then, or, you know, time is an illusion, or, you know, the eternal now or something like that. And it sounds nice, but when you actually, you know, stay with it and really try and grasp what that means, it has a transformative power. So that's something I've found happening with myself when I've, you know, concerned myself with these people's work.
And you still feel connected with Colin Wilson?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I would say, I mean, if there's one person who responsible for my becoming a writer or writing books, it was him. I basically gave up rock and roll when I started reading his books. Not to say anything bad about rock and roll, I mean, but in one sense, it's that and the film industry and other things like that are kind of a sacred cow. I mean, in many people's eyes, there's no life after that. You've done, you know, the ultimate. But I just found his work to, it just opens up so many different areas of thought and possible ways of looking at things and connections between things that that's what I find myself trying to do in the books I've been writing.
Actually, a New York rocker, I'm just remembering you had a little dispute with David Bowie, didn't you, about Colin Wilson and
yes,
an argument with him?
Yes, yes. This was it must have been sometime in the early 80s. I was at kind of a party at a loft space Bowie had in New York, and he introduced. I'd met him before, Blondie. We had opened for Iggy Pop in a North American tour in 77, and Bowie was playing in Iggy's band. He was kind of, you know, incognito, but he was playing in his band. And I'd met him before on the scene a few other times. But in any case, he was talking about sort of magic or something like that. And a friend said to him, "Oh, David, oh, Gary's into all that stuff. You know, he knows Colin Wilson." And Bowie says, "Oh, yes, Colin Wilson, he heads a coven in Cornwall, and it's all this sort of wild sort of stuff, and he's a warlock and all this kind of." And I said, "Well, actually, David, he's not really, you know, he writes about that stuff, and but he's you know, he's more of a philosopher, you know, a critic and all that." "Oh, no, he kept insisting, and eventually his two very attractive female bodyguards. There's a Bond film where these two, like Thumper and Bambi, I can't remember which Bond film it is, with Roger Moore, but these two sort of assassin, but they're, you know, beautiful, you know, model, supermodel types. Any case, it was sort of like that. And they came over to me and said, well, you know, David's a bit tired. You know, maybe it's time you should leave. And I said, well, okay, if you feel like that. I think also that he may remember that he tried to pick up my girlfriend one night at the Mud Club and she passed on him. So okay. maybe he was getting revenge. I don't know.
We only have a few minutes left, but we obviously would like to talk briefly about your new book, right. Jung the Mystic, The Esoteric Dimension of Carl Jung's Life and Teachings. So just tell me how that influenced you. I know you were telling me on the phone the other day that you've been keeping a dream journal over many years.
Well, I mean, Jung is one of the ones I read early on. I mentioned earlier that there was this kind of counter-cultural canon that I got into reading in the early 70s. And Jung was part of that, along with Alan Watson, D.T. Suzuki, and the Beats and all that. It was Memories, Dreams, and Reflections, and there was a book called Man and His Symbols was the last thing he did. But I became very, again, it was this Gnostic idea that, you know, there's some sense that there's something more, something deeper inside, more than, you know, we normally accept of, you know, who we are. And Jung talks about individuation, this whole process of sort of psychic maturity over time, becoming who you are, which is a phrase that I use a lot in that book, and I found to be very sort of useful to sort of characterize, I guess, you know, my own sort of journey, I'm going to put it that way. I did the book on Rudolf Steiner. It's published by Tartar Penguin. I did the book on Rudolf Steiner for them, and it was just in correspondence with the editor, I guess it's a couple of years ago by now, and we just said, oh, it would be good to do another book. Who do you have in mind? And I thought, well, I've always wanted to write about Jung because I've been reading him for years. He's somebody I really would like to kind of nail. Basically, well, this is, you know, this is what I can get out of him. This is what I think he's about. I think Jung, like Steiner, and again, like Swedenborg, they're not exceptionally, how should we say this? They're not exceptionally readable writers. They're not page turners, you know, put it that way. And I think they profit by someone, you know, trying to pull it together and present it in a more simple and clarified way, and I wanted to do that. And I also this sort of ambivalence in Jung about his relationship with the occult or mysticism. It's called Jung the Mystic. Throughout his career, he would insist that he was a scientist. I'm doing science. This is not philosophy. This is not mysticism. This is not the occult. Nothing like that whatsoever. But at the same time, we know that he, you know, was very interested in all those things from early on, and this is what caused his break with Freud and so on and so on. So I just was curious, well, what's going on there? What's that dichotomy? What does that tell us about Jung, and how does that come out in his life and in his work? Something very similar with Steiner. Again, Steiner was this dissonance between, you know, he's talking about philosophy on one page and he's talking about past lives on the other. How do these two things come together? And then also Jung's book, his red book, you know, this dream journal of his, was published last year and caused quite a stir in the literary world and publishing world, and so this renewed interest. And as you say, I had kept a dream journal for a very, 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 very long time, and I discovered many of the things that Jung talks about actually seem to me be concretely real. I mean, I say somewhere in the book, out of all these people that I've sort of pursued, I would say the most immediate kind of evidence I've found has been presented in sort of Jungian terms, in the sense, not so much the archetypes and all that, but just this whole notion of what he calls the unconscious or the self, you know, it being this real thing, you know, that's there. And I can say that I felt its presence. I've felt it concretely in dreams, in a variety of synchronicities and things like that. I mean, I can't explain it. I don't have any way to, you know, I think Jung is sort of talking himself around in circles when he tries to explain synchronicity in sort of scientific terms in that book he wrote in the early 50s with Wolfgang Pauli. I don't come away very convinced by his explanations of it. Not so much the phenomena, which I'm absolutely convinced of, but I'm not convinced by his explanations.
It's very interesting now you come back to using the word presence. And of course, I'm going to actually ask you to read, I printed out the lyrics of the top 10 song you read.
Not the whole lyrics.
Yeah, because I just think it's very interesting you wrote that, and now you're writing all these books about different...
Well, I should preface it by saying that it was a song for my girlfriend at the time, and we discovered that we were having sort of very similar, almost the same sorts of dreams, and calling each other. I mean, I was on tour. I was on tour here in the UK, calling each other at the same time and so on. So we you know, had this sort of connection. All right, well, it's called "I'm Always Touched by Your Presence, Dear." Was it destiny? I don't know yet. Was it just by chance? Could this be kismet? Something in my consciousness told me you'd appear. Now I'm always touched by your presence, dear. When we play at cards, you use an extra sense. You can read my hand, I've got no defense. When you send your messages, whispered loud and clear, I'm always touched by your presence, dear. Floating past the evidence of possibilities, we could navigate together psychic frequencies. I haven't read this in ages. Then the next bridge. Coming into contact with outer entities, we could entertain each one with our theosophies. I stay awake at night and count your REMs when you're talking with your super friends. Levitating lovers in the secret stratospheres, I am still in touch with your presence, dear.
Thank you.
Oh, my pleasure.
It's a great, great place to finish. I'd really like to thank you coming in, Gary.
My pleasure. Thank you.
And talking to us, Conscious TV. And I'll do a plug again for your new book, Jung the Mystic. I haven't read it yet, but hopefully I'm going to read it. And thank you very much for watching Conscious TV. Goodbye.